Hebrews chapter 2. Hebrews chapter 2. Pray for me. We try our best to mind the Lord and do exactly as He wants us to do. I don't want to wear nobody out, but the Bible don't change, man. Can't find no change in it. These verses are still rich every time I read them. I find more and more and more and more in them every time I read them. Amen. All right? Amen. David, you gonna help me out? Yeah, that old snow picture, man. Need to put summertime sweat on there. So. I want to encourage you to read your Bible. We're trying to help everybody with putting the Bible up on the wall. We're trying to be a help. But we don't want you to ever think we're trying to take away from the Bible in your lap. Of course, unless it's not the right kind. But we want you to be able to focus and get as much out of everything as you can get. That's why we're doing it. Right? We're doing it as a help. And we hope that it helps. Hope that it helps you on Sunday and Wednesday and Sunday night. And it seems to be a big help in Sunday school, so we're going to use the technology that God gives us to the best of our ability.
Yeah.
All right. And let it be a tool. All right. Unexpected storm. I like that song.
Yeah.
I like the scripture that we read here a few weeks ago in Jeremiah. Used it in one of the messages that we have an expected end. I'm glad that He's in control. I read the Bible about the storms, and when I read about them, I find that the storms they come, but Jesus either is asleep, not worried, or walking on top of
it. Right, right.
Either way, He's in control.
Yeah.
You know, that means a lot. If He's sleeping, it don't mean that He don't care. The disciples said, thou not carest we perish? He said, I made the storm, that's why I'm asleep. I know how it's made. And then when Jesus wasn't around, they went through a storm. And they look, and here He's walking on top of them. Ain't that amazing? Sometimes it don't seem like He's the ram. Right? That's when He's on top of them. Think about that. I can preach it this morning. I'm not, but I can preach it this morning. Hebrews chapter 2. We're going to start at verse 1. Give you a few thoughts this morning. Therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first began to be spoken by the Lord, and was confirmed unto us by them that heard Him? Pray with me, would you please? Father, I come just now, and I understand again my limitations, my unworthiness, and my inability this morning. I know I can't do nothing, but You can do it all. And Lord, I'm weak in mind. I'm weak in body. Lord, I have no memory. Unless You help me in all these areas, I can do nothing. So, Lord, please strengthen me this morning in a way that Your word will be what will penetrate our heart. God, please give me the memory that's necessary that I can give as You have given me. And Lord, I pray that if You would, that You might give me that fresh oil. Touch me fresh this morning. Give me power that I might preach that Jesus Christ will be lifted up, glorified in every way. Touch me by Holy Spirit, I'm asking. Thank You for what You've done. But Lord, I thank You for what You're doing here this morning. And I'm thanking You for what You're going to do. May You get all glory. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Let's look at them scriptures again, would you, David? If you'll put them back up there again. Hebrews chapter 2, verse 1 says, therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed. The more I've been preaching on this great salvation, the more I see that I need to give the more earnest heed to this great salvation. I need to pay more attention. I've been trying to get away from this, and God keeps putting me back in it. this great salvation that we're looking at.
Yeah.
And I ought to pay attention to what I'm listening to. I ought to pay attention to what I'm reading when I think about this great salvation. It says, to give more attention to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. Man, how much has slipped through our fingers?
Yeah.
How much has slipped by us? How much has slipped our mind?
Right.
How many places have we just slipped?
Right.
When I think about this great salvation, we look at it. Verse 2 then says, for if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape? How shall we escape? Are there an escape? No, not if we neglect this salvation. We're going to be in a world of hurt. We can't neglect this great salvation. So many of us, we get saved and we're happy we're saved and we do good, and then we neglect this salvation. Now, a lot of times we get confused and we think that neglecting salvation is neglecting church. Can I tell you that the reason people neglect church today is because they neglect salvation. The reason that people neglect their praying is because they neglect salvation. The reason that people neglect reading their Bible is because they neglect salvation. The reason being is because this salvation is not a thing, but it's a person. Verse 3 says, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? So great salvation. Now we know, and we're going to repeat it for as long as I can, that it's not a program. It's not a plan. It's not a prayer. But it's a person. This salvation is a person. I think we missed it for years.
Right.
You know what? I think we missed it for years.
Right.
When we read that about neglecting salvation, it didn't register that we was neglecting Jesus.
Right.
It didn't register.
Right.
We put it all in the format. We put it all in forms and figures and programs and tradition of the church. But the Bible says in 1 John chapter 11, or chapter 1 John chapter 5, verse 11, and this is a record that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in His Son. Verse 12 says, he that hath the Son hath life, and he that hath not the Son of God hath not life. That salvation in its fullest, that is this great salvation, so great salvation. I was reading again last night and yesterday and this morning, and when I looked at this, I can't find a better text. I can't find a better passage. I can't find a more richer text than this right here. I can't find something I could go all over the Bible through this text right here. So great salvation. And when I was looking at it, I said, man, he's all in all. It's everything. Look with me, Colossians chapter 1. Colossians chapter 1. And look here what it says. I kept reading this. I love the book of Colossians. And we'll get to the message here in a minute. You just bear with me. Listen. Colossians chapter 1, verse 16 says, for by him were all things created. By him. By him who? Oh, great salvation.
Yeah.
Are you hearing me? So great salvation. We're talking about Jesus this morning. By him were all things created that are in heaven and that are in earth, visible and invisible, whether it be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him. So great salvation. And for him. So great salvation. That's who we're talking about. We all right? And he is before all things. Who is? So great salvation is before all things. Is it not true? Before the world, the foundation of the world was laid, the Lamb was slain. So great salvation was before all things. Am I right? Huh? Says that he is before all things, and by him all things consist. Can I tell you, everything's wrapped up in so great salvation. Everything is. Verse 18 then goes on and says, and he is the head of the body. How do we get a body? So great salvation. The church calls it so great salvation. Who's beginning? The firstborn from the dead. That's oh so great salvation. That in all things he might have the preeminence. Why? Because he's so great salvation. That's why. So that's why. Verse 19 then says, for it pleased the Father that in him should all fullness dwell. That in so great salvation, all fullness dwells in so great salvation. Now, you say, well, you read that out of context. No, that's exactly the way the Bible reads right there. It's so great salvation. And I can't exhaust it. I can't tell it all. I've been trying. You realize it's been, 11, 12 weeks? I've been trying to tell about this great salvation. And I keep finding more and more and more on this great salvation. Now, when I think about this salvation, then there's a passage that comes to me that we so often look at it in certain lights. And I want us to look at a little passage, give you a few thoughts this morning. Now, this great salvation is good to be saved by, right? Then it's good to live by. Am I right? But I wonder, is it going to be good when we get home? Is this so great salvation going to be good when we get home? See, it's good all the way. What I found this morning, that there's nobody like Jesus. I found there's nobody like him when I need a Savior. And there's nobody like him when I have a storm. In this land, there's nobody like him. When I leave this world to go to the next, there'll be nobody like him. There's nothing any greater than being saved now. There's nothing being no greater than being saved in the coming year. But there ain't nothing any greater than being with him. So great salvation when we get home. It really is great. It really is great. I just don't know anything any better. And someday we're going to be home. So I want us to look at Luke chapter 15. Well, this is going to be an odd place to go home. But let's just see if we can't get home from here. Can we? Would you read with me? We're on the board there. If you want to read your Bible, that's fine. We're in Luke chapter 15, verse 11. I'm going to read a little bit. It says, and he said, a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that fall to me. He divided unto them his living. Not many days after the younger son gathered all together, took his journey to a far country. There wasted his substance with riotous living. When he had spent all, there rose a mighty famine in that land, and he began to be in want. He went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into the fields to feed swine. He would fain to fill his belly with the husk that the swine did eat. No man gave it to him. When he came to himself, he said, how many hired servants of my father's have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger. I will arise and go to my father, saying to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before thee, and am no more worthy to be called thy son. Make me as one of thy hired servants. And he rose, came to his father, but when he was yet a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion, and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven in thy sight, no more worthy to be called thy son. But the father said to his servant, bring forth the best robe and put it on it, put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. Bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found, and they began to be merry. Now I know that this passage has been preached several ways. I know that. And if we look at the very place of the scripture and the very main meaning, I'm not trying to get the Bible to mean something that it don't, but I look at this and I see the main subject, the way I see it anyway, I'm giving you what the Bible speaks to me, if I could. I see rebellion when I read this passage of Scripture. I see the rebellion of a backslider. That's what I see first. I see this rebellion, and we can relate to that, can we not? Talk to me. If you can relate to that, relate to the rebellion of a backslider. Huh? Then I can relate. Then I look here and I see the ruin of his life. Can relate to that this morning. How that we go back on God and we find things ruined in our life. I mean, that's a normal thing. That's what this passage speaks to me about. I see the rebellion. I see the ruin, if you would. And then I see the repentance. Right? I think about that rebellion. You know, we're all rebellious. Every one of us are rebellious. Every one of us are rebellious. To the hill. I mean, we're rebellious. And every one of us is ruined to a point. We're either ruined by sin or spoiled by grace. But we're ruined either way. Do you know a lot of us are spoiled by grace and are far off from the Lord?
You're right. You're exactly right.
You ever think of that? We've sucked on it so long.
Right. Go ahead, buddy.
We can't even taste it anymore.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah. Think about that. Then I see repentance. I see where this old boy had to repent. Had to say, I sinned. We can relate to that, can't we? Then I see, not only that, then I see the return. That's all for the backslider. Welcome to the Lord. I see that. Now, we've heard it preached like that hundreds of times, haven't we?
Oh, yeah.
Then, on the other hand, I've heard it preached even another way. I've even preached it the other way. Just hang with me now. I see where it preaches to a sinner man. Where I see it preaches to the rottenness of a sinner. You know, it really is rotten to take everything dad's got and run away. You really are a rotten scoundrel to take everything that the Father gives and run away without no thankfulness. That's what a sinner does. You know that? That's really rotten. To go and waste it. How many lost people waste their life to nothing? Take everything. God's breath, God's grace, God's mercy, God's wonderful creation. Take it all and waste your life, never giving God a time of day.
Right.
That's rot. You just rot to do that. Is that not true? But then I see here the reality of sin. Boy, when you are rotten to the core, you'll find that sin's got a reality to it. Boy, it'll bite at the end, it'll bite. It'll tear you apart. Look what sin has done. Homes broken. Lives broken. Crippled. We go to the jail. Let me tell you what. We go to the jail and we preach to people every month that are rotten to the core. And now they're seeing the reality of sin. And if we got our just desserts before we got saved, we'd have been in the jailhouse if you already ain't done been there. Huh? Called we're guilty. Called we're wicked. Huh? And the reality of sin is not what we thought it was. We was teaching the women Friday night, and we was talking about how before they got put in jail, they didn't see nothing wrong with what they were doing. That's the way we are. As long as everything's good, we don't see nothing wrong with what we're doing. But boy, when it stops and we get caught, then they say, man, that's bad. That's the reality of sin. That's what I see here about this boy. I see a backslider, and then I can see a lost man. I see that reality of sin, the rottenness of the sinner. But then I see something else. I see the Redeemer reconciled.
Amen.
You know, Oh, ain't that a blessing?
Yeah.
When you're rotten to the core, when you ain't fit to kill,
yeah.
When reality of sin has done step over your soul, there stands a Redeemer waiting to reconcile you and Him together. You don't get it no better than that, man. That's what I see in that passage. This ain't none of the message. This is just what I see in this passage. That all right? Then I see not only the reconciling of the Redeemer, but I see the ring. I see the ring of royalty. You know what that does? That showed me I belong to Him. Yeah. I remember when I was lost and undone.
Sure.
And He put that ring of sonship on my hand. Wow. That ring of royalty that I am now a king and a priest of God. Yeah. That's what I see in there. That's all in there.
That ain't what we're going to preach.
See, this is great salvation we're talking about.
Yeah.
So great salvation. It's going to be good when we get home.
Man.
That's what I'm going to preach on this morning if I can. So great salvation when we get home. When we get home. Now, to read all this passage, I want us to look back at verse 13. I look here at Luke 15, 13. You throw it up there. Not many days after the younger son gathered all together and took his journey into a far country, there wasted his substance with riotous living. You know, when we get home, now listen to me now, look at me. This great salvation is so great, we can't exhaust it, we can't tell it all, we can't tell all what happens. But can I tell you a real good part of this great salvation? There's some things that's going to be behind us when we get home.
Yes.
Because of this great salvation.
Yes.
There's some things that's going to be behind us. Now, what you think about this?
Yeah.
There's a lot of things we deal with every day.
Right.
Oh, but that wonderful day when we get to go home, there's going to be some things left behind.
Yeah.
First thing I think about, it's right here. There's not going to be no more separation.
Hey. Amen.
Father is at home. And he's got a boy that's not with him. That's what I read in this passage. Can you see it in there? They're separated. They're separated from in another land. Separated in another way of living. Can I tell you this morning that it's not heaven here? In case you didn't notice. It's not heaven here. Huh? But it's heaven there. We get home, we're going to leave this behind.
Right.
Ain't going to be no more separation no more.
Man.
Sometimes it seems like the Father is a long way off. Sometimes it seems like family is a long way off.
Yeah.
But boy, when we get home, because of this great salvation, because of this wonderful Savior and the wonderful Redeemer, Jesus Christ,
right.
Something is going to be left behind is separation. Is that all right with y'all?
Yeah.
Huh? Then I see something else. There's not going to be no more sin.
Praise the Lord.
He wasted his life with his substance, with righteous living. When I get there, I'm going to leave all this behind.
Right, yeah, glory.
Boy, I'm going to leave my failures behind.
Yeah.
I'm going to leave my mistakes behind. I'm going to leave my disappointments behind. All that's going to be gone. I'm not going to have that no more. See, it'll be good when I get home, but I can't go home unless I have this great salvation. Be all right? Think about it. No more separation. No more sin. Huh? No more strain. He joined himself to a far country. Not going to stray no more. You ever stray? You ever stray?
Sure.
Yeah.
Oh, it's hard to stray. You know, it's hard sometimes to hang in there. The boy, when we get home, there'll be no more straying. This great salvation keeps everybody safe.
Amen.
Keeps everybody in the fold. We all right with that this morning? I'm still talking about this great salvation. Not only are there some things that's going to be left behind in that respect, there's going to be some things before us. How about verse 20? Luke 15 and 20. It says, and when he arose and came to his father, when he was a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. So he started home. They something ahead. I'm going to leave some stuff behind. I think a lot. I know it don't appear that way, but I think a lot. I used to listen to preaching on the radio or the tape, and I don't do that no more. I used to listen to music, and it's rare that I'll listen to a song anymore. I can't concentrate on to listen to a whole song. It's hard for me to get to one place or another. I go by it. That's why I'm early, because I'm going to leave early, because I'm always going past or going somewhere else instead of going where I'm supposed to go. It's getting worse. I'm telling you the truth. I ain't absent-minded. That one pea is rolling around in that bucket up here. I just can't get it in the slot. You know what I mean? Huh? But as I travel, I think. And I think about what I didn't get done.
Yeah.
And I think about what I messed up.
Yeah.
And I think about all the trouble and trial. That's what I find myself thinking.
Yeah.
And the only thing that keeps me going is this great salvation.
Amen.
Because someday I know I'm going to leave it all behind. You look at people's lives and deal with people daily and you see their trouble and you can't fix their problems. You can't fix their broken hearts. You can't fix their sin. But oh, if they'll just get that great salvation, they'll get to leave that behind too. I deal with people when death comes and you can't bring their loved one back and you can't fix the broken place that's in their heart. But the only thing that makes it okay is that great salvation that you leave all this behind and all the separation and all the sin and all the strain and you get to go there because of that great salvation. And then I turn it around and not only see what I've lost and the mistake, but then I get to thinking of what I'm going to gain. That's usually when I go past where I'm supposed to stop. Because I think about the game. Think about what we're going to get. Have you ever thought about what waits ahead? What really waits ahead? He said, I'll rise and go to my Father. Can I tell you that what waits ahead? When we get home, we get to see him.
Amen.
I can't see where I'm at now.
Right.
I only see him through the eye of faith. But when I get home, I wonder how long that prodigal had been away. I don't know how many years. I wonder how often he would sit in that old pen like this old world, an old slop pen. That's what we're living in right now.
Yeah.
I wonder how long that prodigal was gone and said, I wonder what Dad looks like. I can't even remember what he looks like. Do you have trouble remembering some that's done gone? What do they look like? You can go find their picture, and that reminds you that there's problems and there's things that separate. Are we okay this morning?
Oh, yeah.
And then the prodigal said, I think I'll go back to my Father. Now when we think of the things that's before us, we're not going to see him on a cross.
Right.
We're not going to see that.
Right.
We're going to see the prints in his hand.
Yep.
We'll see the prints in his feet.
Right.
We'll see the place in his side where outflowed blood and water.
Yeah.
But then it says in 1 John chapter 3, if you'll shine it up on the wall, it says that, beloved, now are we the sons of God. That old boy was a son.
Yes.
Down there in the home pit. Can I tell you this morning, I'm a son. I'm a son right here in the slump of this world. I like what it says. And it does not yet appear what we shall be. I can't figure it out yet. But this one thing I know. Are you with me this morning? That when he shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is. There's some things I'm going to leave behind, but thank God there's some things that lay before me that I'm going to get to see before me. I'm going to get to see him. The one that suffered and bled and died for me. I'm not interested in a pearly gate. I'm not interested in a street of gold. I'm not interested in a wall of jasper. Oh, but if I could just get a glimpse of him. I don't even care if I get a hugging. I don't care if I don't get to touch him. If I just are in the crowd. And I read that old book by Larkin, and he talks about the shining ones going up in that observatory. And he said, we might not even see him, but we'll always know he's there. There must be a glow walk by. Boy, I just, if I can just see him as he is. My Redeemer. The one that's been there through the dark night. The one that I couldn't see, but I felt. The one that I couldn't see his hand, but I could feel his hand on me. The one that I couldn't feel his breast, but boy, I could feel him as he carried me down through the life. The one that I couldn't see his feet, but I knew that he walked by me. That's the one that I get to see. And I don't know about you this morning, but when I get home, this great salvation is going to be more real than it is today. We all right with that? So great salvation. Some things we're going to leave behind. We're going to get to see the Savior. To see the Father is what we're going to do. Not only that, there's going to be something else. We're going to be fashioned as he is. It says that we shall see him as he is and we shall be like him. Boy, won't that be a blessing? Yeah, people say we'll all be 33 and a half years old. I don't know where everybody gets that. That ain't the Bible. Well, you put all that together. No, it ain't the Bible. It just said we'll be like him. Right. That means we ain't going to have no sin. Right. We all right with that? Right. There's going to be no more sin. We're not going to be worried about a clock.
Right.
Not going to be worried about a dollar.
Right.
We'll be like him. We only want to glorify the Father. We'll be like him. We'll love everybody. We'll be like him. We won't have no ill will in our mind. We'll be like him. Everybody wants to be 33 and a half years old. I didn't like it when I was 33 and a half years old. I'm having more fun now. It's almost 53. We all right? Some of you wish you was 33 and a half, Tristan, and she's 40. Never see that again. Are you listening to me? There's good things ahead. We fashion like you, but there's even more than that. We all right? I keep finding stuff in here. I can't help it. See, when we get home, there will be things behind us. When we get home, there will be things before us. But when we get home, how about this? There'll be some things that's just going to bless us. How about that? All because of this great salvation. There's going to be some things that just bless us. Well, what is it? Well, let's look at verse 23. See if we can find it. It says, and bring hither the fatted calf and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. Well, we're going to a feast. How about some things just makes us happy? What makes us happier than anything? We can't have nothing without eating. Can we? Is that not the way to look at us? We ain't none of us forgot to eat. Ain't it be good to have a feast? Some things is going to bless us. We're going to have a feast. They're going to come from the east and the west and the north and the south. They're going to come that's been weather-worn and sick and hurt and sorry and sinful. And all that mess is going to be forgotten and left behind. We're going to see the Father. We're going to be made like Him all because of this so great salvation. Then we're going to sit down at a big table. And Him, the one who's altogether lovely, is going to break bread and pass it down. And the fatted calf will be, I don't know what we're going to eat, but it's going to be great. And I thought, boy, that's going to be fine. That'd be a marriage supper like none other. But you know what I found out? They ate more than that. Didn't notice it till this morning. Look at verse 24. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. That meant it was just starting. That's what I saw this morning. That when we get there, when we get home, it's just getting started. Is that all right? How much better is it going to get? When we get there, we're going to eat. When we get there, we're going to sit down together. When we get there, everything, all the troubles and trials are gone. All the hurt's gone. All the pain's gone. All the sin's gone. Family together again. Then it's going to start. Is that all right? You know why? Because of this great salvation. Because of Jesus. So great. Salvation. This simple this morning. So great salvation. The sad part is it's great. He's great. Salvation's great because it's Jesus. But there's many that don't have it. Do you have it this morning? Are you saved this morning? Are you saved? Do you know that you know that you know that you're saved this morning? Well, I think I was. No. Well, I used to be. No. No. Well, I hope I am. No. Are you saved this morning? Do you know Jesus as your Savior? Do you really know Him? Has He changed your life? Do you really know Him this morning? If you don't know Him this morning, then you're going to miss out on all of this.
Right.
You're not going to leave nothing behind.
Right.
You have nothing to look forward to. And there'll be no blessing after you get there.
Right.
So great salvation. I've looked and I've looked and I've looked. The Bible still says, how shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation? You've had time for everything else now.
Yep.
You've done had time. You've lived your life. You listening to me? Living your life, you think you've had it all. But you're really not saved. You got a good family. Some of you maybe done up in the evening time of life. Had it all, but you don't have Jesus. You watch family go one by one. One by one, they've journeyed across. You're left and you're not sure that you'll see them again.
What?
You're not sure you're saved. Some are sure they're not saved. Why won't you take this great salvation this morning? Why won't you take Jesus? Why wouldn't you? Why wouldn't you take Him? See, it's not a plan, it's not a prayer, it's not a program.
Right.
It's a person. And because of this great salvation, I'm going to leave it all behind. Because of this great salvation, man, I've got a lot to look forward to. I look at the way things are. You know what lays on our mind all the time, personally. You know, Zach, Jared was here a while ago. We all spend time together. I know what I believe is going to take place. I know all that. I don't doubt that God will raise him up at his time. But you know, I may not see it. I may not see it. I may not see him walk again. I don't know how much time I have. I may not see him. I may not see him walk back in this church again. But you know what I'm assured of is someday I'll walk with him.
Amen.
See, that I'm assured of.
Yeah.
There's some of my people I've never met. They was gone before I ever come in this world.
Yeah.
But I'll walk with him.
Yeah, yes, sir.
See, I got so much to look forward to. So much. But if you're not saved, you don't have nothing to look forward to. See, saved ain't coming to church. Saved ain't going to church. Saved ain't reading your Bible or carrying your Bible or praying. Saved is knowing Jesus in your heart. That is Savior, that is God. I look back there and I see Kim sitting there. Last Sunday night, Kim walked up this aisle when I done read my text and said, I can't wait to the end of service. And Kim, I'm not going to take your lightning and thunder, honey. But she said, I've been in church. I went out of church then for 20 years. I thought, trying all these years to convince myself I was saved. But not knowing until tonight, and last Sunday night,
amen.
Kim Sanford trusted Jesus.
Amen.
Are you saved tonight? Are you saved today? Are you saved? Do you know this great salvation? I've got so much to look forward to. See, Cheryl, I don't worry about us not seeing one another again. If you go before me, wait, I'll be there. If I go before you, I'll be waiting for you again. It ain't gonna matter. No big deal. I got that to look forward to. I got loved ones. And all that's wonderful. Is that not a wonderful thought? But see, it's more than that. It's more than that. You realize what you're missing? Cheryl, you go to bed. I'm going to ask you this morning to bow your head. I've not done this for a long time. I'm going to ask you to lift your hand. That's what you bow your head over. I want to talk to you for a moment. This very well could be the last message in this series. So great a salvation. I've been got us home now. Maybe that'll be it. I don't know. Can I ask you right seriously, Cheryl, you play when you find it, honey. You go ahead and start. And I'm wondering this morning, as God has allowed you to come this way again today, are you saved? Are you saved this morning? If you're not saved, why wait? What's the purpose in waiting? Are you watching someone? Are you waiting to see if you get better? Are you trying? None of that works. judging someone, then you're looking at the wrong one. You need to look to Jesus. If you're waiting to get better, I'm sorry, you're going to get worse. You're not going to get better. I'm wondering, why do you wait? The greatest thing you can have is this great salvation. Wouldn't you like to trust Him today? Wouldn't you like to come and repent of your sins and place your faith in the Lord Jesus Christ? Would you be willing to slip out of your seat this morning and do that? Would you? Would you be willing to do that? Why ain't nobody looking if you won't do that? I wonder, would you just maybe do this for me this morning? Would you at least lift your hand if you're lost and you know you're lost and say, Mark, I know I'm not saved. Would you keep praying for me? Would you at least do that this morning? Would you at least do that this morning? Hand right up. I see the hand. Bend up. Think about it. I see it. Hey. And I'm going to keep praying. I'm going to keep praying for you that you trust the Lord Jesus. Because you're so special. You're so important. And you need Him so bad. And I'm wondering this morning, have you slipped away from this great salvation? You walked with Him and felt His presence and been so real in your heart, but you slipped away. Wouldn't it be good this morning to slip on back, put your feet under the table, and eat of His blessings until we get home? He's packed an awful good lunch for us to eat on the way. Maybe you could just slip back under the lunch table here and eat a bite with the Lord. Would you like to do that this morning? Oh, neighbor, we're missing so much. We're missing so much. Father, speak into our heart today. Thank you that when we get home, it'll be because of this great salvation. And all the things that's left behind, thank you. For all the things we got to look forward to, thank you. And for the things that are just going to bless us, oh, we sure do thank you. In Jesus' name, and amen. Let's stand. Would you stand?